about, because he went down to the gas station, you guys brought him in, and we opened him back up, but then he'd been down. He was a V-fib arrest, so afterward, we did use hypothermia on him. So Dr. Prempeh is going to talk about kind of what you guys in the field do to make things happen on IPN, and some of the ways we can work together. But this is just kind of a case study, so you can see what we go over every week when we do case studies. Basically, we do a presentation. Quick thing, he was 34 years old. He came by EMS, and he was a witness arrest at a gas station. His only history was he was a smoker. And then we also try to include the EMS notes into our weekly presentation, just so we can kind of get a feel of what you guys do in the field. And this is just a really small clip of what we put in there, but it shows, you know, what times you guys got there. It shows, obviously, you were doing CPR. This guy was intubated, he was put on a monitor, and it gives just like the brief synopsis of your report, so we kind of get a history of what happened in the field. Then we look at the EKGs. This guy did not have one that was transmitted. His first EKG was when he was on arrival. Obviously, he was in a V-fib arrest. You guys were tied up with that, intubated. Plus, he was just here on Tennessee Street, so his trip time was super short. But we show the EKG that activated a Stemi for us. And we go over that in our weekly presentation. Then we go over what procedure was done. In this case, he had and a lot of these are in terms from cath lab, but he had a two-vessel disease. And he had a 99% blockage of his ON3. He had a chronic total occlusion, 100% of his proximal RCA, 50 to 60% of his proximal ramus. But he did have collateral. So this guy, even though he was 34 with no history that we know of, had already, you know, been having heart issues that, you know, he had collaterals. So he did end up getting a stent. And then we break it down by time. So we know when a patient comes in, we look at the times that they came in, arrival time, EKG time, what time we activated, which is MI line called, is when we call a STEMI, when they get to the cath lab, when the procedure begins, and when we get a flow restored. And in his case, he was 94 minutes, but he did have a delay because we thought the culprit lesion, because he's a young 34-year-old guy, we think, oh, his right is the problem, so we start over there, but we realized it was chronically occluded. His problem was on the left. So there was a reason for that delay, but, you know, delays can happen in all cases. When you're activated early and we know what's going on, even when these delays happen, our times are still pretty good. And then we also look at EMS times, because this is important for us as well. We like to know how long the pain started in 911. In this case, he was in arrest. We don't know how long he'd been having pain. He came in, he was totally unresponsive, so we couldn't ask him these questions. But we know what time the call is, what time you can get there, first point of contact. One thing that's really important to us is this bottom one, first point of contact to return to flow. We want to know how long it was for you to get to that patient till we get a return to flow. And that's one thing we like to track. And we know that his first point of contact, EKG, in this case, he was in a V-fib arrest. So that's why you guys were, there was not an EKG in the field, because you guys, you know, were managing the arrest. So we look at all our times. We look at what happened to bring the patient in to us. We discuss any issues or comments. So that's kind of what we do every week for every STEMI case that comes in our door. We review every one. We look at what you guys do, we look at our times, and then on top of that, what we do is we go in and we actually look at the procedure, and we look and see if there's anything on our end that we need to improve on in this case. In this case, we realized we totally knew that his problem was, or thought his problem was on the right. He did. He had 100% occlusion on the right. However, in this young guy, we realized he had problems on the left too. So that helps us change our mindset of, oh, even though it could be on the right, we need to look at the left too. So, and if there's anything here you want to walk through, Dr. Prempeh. obviously this right's pretty much gone with some collaterals. Because this is the right side.
So typically, based on the EKG that we got when we came in, typically the problem would be on the right side, the right coronary artery. And so we, in a young guy, you expect not to have multiple, you know, blockages, and maybe just one artery that caused a heart attack. So in him, in order to save time, because time was critical to him, you know, we went to the right, and he had this cardiac occlusion for which I thought was going to be the lesion, and we were going to try and work on it. I think we actually worked on it for a little bit, and then I realized that it was just too hard and too tough, that it's probably chronic. And we then switched to go to the left, and in him, go to the next shot, in him we saw a culprit lesion in the left coronary artery.
We hit a 99% OM3 on this one. He had 50 to 60% rainness as well.
Okay, keep going. There it is.
Right here?
Yeah.
So you see, it's kind of hard to see when it's moving. You can see it right here.
See at the bottom there?
Right here.
That was just that
hard. I don't know if I can stop it. You see it right here.
Which goes to the bottom of the heart, so if it's well bottom. Lateral part of the heart. So we ended up fixing that.
Here's what you see with the wire. Go ahead and get it open.
And then we had answers that the right was truly occluded chronically, because you can see collaterals going from the left to the right, which tells you it's a chronic process. That the heart's been compensated for that blockage for some time. I don't know if you can pick out whatever so they can see a collateral going to the right.
Are collaterals on this side?
You
want me to stop
this?
Yeah. Well, we get it.
Right in here.
We get it.
If you look at this area, you'll see some vessels forming. For me, that's coming. For me, this vessel forming. The right coronary artery comes in this territory from this side and comes down here like that. So the collaterals are trying to feed that territory with these collaterals. You'll see some branches coming here if you let them play.
So we get to the right, we realize it's totally shut off. You see the collaterals coming off the right, you get over to the left, you see the blockage, and then you see the front collaterals coming off the left.
Right, the collaterals.
Or coming from the right
from
to the left.
No, the collaterals coming from the
left
to the right. Tells you that.
Was there anything else? I mean, I know they said he was just a smoker. Sedentary lifestyle, was he obese or?
No, he likes a pretty shot though. But no, his issue was that he was drinking a lot of alcohol.
Okay.
And he was taking a lot of Monster drinks and energy, 5 hours, those you know, energy drinks.
Mm-hmm.
He was trying to work long hours, trying to make some money. He had a lot of stress, family issues. And this guy who was what, 20 something?
34.
34?
Mm-hmm. Young, healthy looking guy.
That was it. But obviously he has a genetic component that you know is involved, because he could see that not only did the stress cause him to have a heart attack, but he already had blockage on the right well before that, probably years before that. And so someone that young that has that degree of blockages, usually there's a genetic component that contributes to it. So all together, genetics and then all the stress and the energy drinks and all that stuff probably kind of contributed to his heart attack.
And didn't he say, you know, he had a strong family history, and then didn't he eat a lot of bacon and a lot of fatty meats?
Yeah,
we're serving bacon this morning. But I mean,
maybe we need to change our diet.
Bacon is my favorite food. But I mean, he had a lot of bacon. Didn't he say he ate like a lot of bacon?
Could this have been the hereditary portion of it or the genetic portion of it? Could this have been diagnosed previously, or was it just something that was just going to happen when it happened?
He had blockages. I mean, this could have been picked up earlier. Had he developed symptoms or reported symptoms to someone that was keeping a close eye, and if someone hit that young, it could have been blown off. And not only that, it could be blown off in him. You know, he could probably, you know, when you're very young, you can withstand a lot. And so maybe he was having some symptoms, but just didn't really attribute it to anything, and kind of just was working through it.
Slept down.
And he said, it has something going on, but you know, you kind of go through it, and at your young age, you can kind of bear through a lot of things. And so it just never got. But if he had come and said, you know, every time I try to do stuff, I just can't move the way I normally can, then somebody would have possibly done a stress test, and likely that would have been picked up. The right occlusion would have been picked up. Now, the one that happened for his cardiac arrest, that's a sudden event. And usually that happens in a plaque that's not very blocked at all, in a 20% blockage, 30% blockage, and then it'll just rupture and cause a clot in the artery. And that's what happened here. And then that caused a heart attack, caused irritation in the muscle fibers, which then caused the arrest.
Oh, I went back to that screen that we want to show on this one.
Yeah, you let it play. I just wanted to see the collaterals.
Oh, right on.
Yeah,
here.
Right in there.
Where it's starting to try to feed that side part
right.
from this side, because
right.
this side's so blocked for so long,
exactly.
it's just moving over here to help feed it. So this is where you get the balloon down.
So this is us.
Oh, sorry.
Sorry. This is us working balloon and then stent.
Stent
and him. He looked at his elbow function. And as you can see here, you see the bottom part of the heart is not quite moving as well. It's kind of see where we see the effects of the heart attack. So this is the inside of the chambers of the heart. You see this bottom part here is not really moving as much. This part is moving much better. So from like that point, wrap around was okay, but this point is not moving. Much mainly this middle part right here doesn't squeeze in very well, so that's the result of this heart attack. And you know, you can get recovery of that with time out of this flow, and he actually did have full recovery of his elbow function. His heart function was normal, and ultimately this guy walked out totally fine. But we got to go through this. Is time for the recovery.
This is when you're going to really talk about it.
Okay. So basically, I'll just stand up a bit. Basically,
you want to overdo that? I mean, I don't think you want to do any films
so
or anything.
You just go back to the trip sheet of the time breakdown. So I particularly want to talk about the time breakdown that we have in the hospital and how we make decisions. Specifically, when they have a cardiac arrest associated with their STEMI, we need to really have some information to kind of have decision tree or have a decision tree regarding their treatment. So for instance, if someone has a cardiac arrest, what we want to know when you get there is how long they've been down. So obviously, when you get there, you get the call, if you're getting there, ask them how long you get down before you call the EMS. So we look at that time between when they went down, first bystanders, first person to come by and do any resuscitation, how long did that take? Because we have data that shows that if it's greater than sort of the 10 to 15 minute range, that the outcomes are very, very poor, no matter what we do. And so we need to know from the time they went down, when was the first point at which somebody recognized it and started CPR. Then after that, we need to know how long did it take from the call for you guys to get there. And when you get there, what was the initial rhythm? So we're dealing with time and rhythm. Now the rhythm is important because if it's VT, VF, that is a high likelihood that it's a cardiac etiology, okay? If it's PEA or a systole, it's a lower likelihood that it's ischemic cardiac etiology, okay? And when I say cardiac, they're all cardiac arrest, but the inciting event is primarily from the heart rather than due to something else like infection or pneumonia or septic shock, you know, something like that, or electrolyte abnormalities, versus they have a plaque rupture in their artery that caused the refib arrest. So if you see VTVF, that's the initial rhythm. That's what we kind of want to know. What was that initial rhythm? Now, the next crucial point is that from the time you got the initial rhythm, how long did it take you to resuscitate the patient? And what were the rhythms in between? Because the reality is that if it's greater than 60 minutes of resuscitation, total resuscitation, which is a long time, then obviously the chances that neurologically you're going to have any recovery is very low. And we don't even try to put them on a hypothermia protocol, which is something we're trying to implement more at this time. So those parameters in terms of time before they even get to the hospital kind of helps us decide on whether or not we need to put them on a hypothermia protocol or not.
What's the time limit for the hypothermia protocol?
So for resuscitation efforts, it's 60 minutes
total.
So they, you know, so from the time they went down to the time you actually restore flow, it's greater than 60 minutes. It's not even, we won't even.
But anything from 60 and below?
Yeah, again, there's other caveats. So like, let's say, that's why we need to know when they went down, when was the first start of CPR. So if that's like 20 minutes, then it's probably unlikely that we're going to do hypothermic protocol in that setting too. And then if it's PEA or a systole, then, you know, depending on the situation, we may not do it in those settings too. Because the greatest data regarding the hypothermic protocol comes in VFib and VTAC arrest. The PEA and a systole does have some data, but it's not as strong as when it's VT or VF. And then the time, like I said, if it's more than 20 minutes that they've been down and they had no real CPR, the chances are very unlikely that they're going to survive that event, and so we wouldn't do the hypothermic protocol in those settings too. And then again, your efforts, how long it took you to resuscitate them, whether it be FV, atropine, CPR, all the rest. So what we're trying to do essentially is, because oftentimes when they come into the ER, everyone's just, you know, going wild trying to get the person resuscitated, but forgetting about some of those time restraints that we have. And so we ended up putting people on hypothermic protocol, but probably shouldn't have been on hypothermic protocol to begin with. So if we can hone it down and really get to the ones that we really think would benefit, that'd be awesome. And even on the hypothermic protocol, obviously survival is still low. But it gives them a chance in certain patients. So we actually do want to use it. We see the effectiveness of it. But we need those times. So I'm thinking that in some way, however it can be efficient for you guys, is to kind of come up with something where that's sort of automatic. Where I don't know if it's a sheet of paper that just has a checklist and maybe a line that puts the time. And just it's just a quick, we have the statements that we need. Like time from down to time to call 911, time down to first CPR, time down to port of contact to first resuscitation, return of circulation. Having those downs in there, you could just look at that and just kind of put in whatever they tell you and whatever you do when you're there, and then just hand us the sheet or something like that. That way, we can look at something quickly and be able to say this person qualifies or doesn't qualify for hypothermic protocol. And so I don't know, I know you've got a lot of other things to do, but the question is how can we make that easier for you to get that information and transfer it over to us to ultimately help the patient. I know that there are some other programs outside of Bartow and some other areas that I've heard where EMS has, they have a protocol and they kind of just go through that protocol and they just kind of make their checklist or put down those times. And it's just kind of handed over to the physicians, and then they can make decisions based on that. And it's worked pretty good. Not only that, those things can be transmitted or talked to before you even get to the hospital. And sometimes in some EMS, you can start the hypothermic protocol in the truck. And some easy ways of doing that is just to use cold normal saline as a method of cooling the patient. So you just put a bag up. It's if you have like a little freezer or something like that where you can cool the saline and keep it stored in the truck. And then, you know, if you have a patient, you just hook them up to the saline line, and then that's their method of cooling until they get to the hospital. It's very effective. Every minute counts. And so that's down the line. And I'm sure that down the line, some more and more of those types of methods are going to be used. When they get here, we have a different system. But it could be a transition. The bottom line is to try to get their core temperature down. And so cold normal saline, or even some people you just use ice packs. You know, you just have smart packs, put them in on the arms, all of their bodies, their legs, and kind of get their temperature down that way. But the key is, I think, mostly in terms of dealing with these patients and giving them the most effective therapy is kind of identifying those patients who would benefit the most. And how we know that is by getting a few extra steps in terms of time that things happen prior to coming into the ER. Do you guys have any kind of suggestions or roadblocks that you think of that?
One of the main roadblocks that I see that kind of pops up is not as much as far as keeping track of time once we arrive on scene, is a discrepancy prior to our arrival. Because generally it's kind of a chaotic situation. It's, you know, wife found her husband down, husband found his wife down, whatever the case may be. And what we find is that it can be anywhere from 30 minutes to an hour discrepancy in the time.
Right.
When was the last time you saw them? Well, I saw them 15 minutes ago. Okay, when was the last time you actually talked to them? 2 hours ago. You know, there's a huge discrepancy in time as far as when they actually, last time they saw the person breathing and the time down.
We rarely run a call where we actually, we're responding because they watched them go down.
As far as like an actual, I saw them take their last breath.
Right.
You know, and they collapse or whatever the case may be. As far as keeping up with time when we get there, I believe we, you know, are exceptional as far as that's concerned, as far as keeping track of that.
Well, a couple things with that. I understand and I think that's the key point. But what I would say is it's also very beneficial for us to know for sure that we don't know. You see what I'm saying? Like, for you to tell me that if there's a discrepancy, it could be from 30 minutes to 2 hours, it's still helpful than me not knowing what we know. You know what I mean? So I think that's why if we just have these bullet point questions, it kind of allows us to streamline things a lot faster because we say, all right, well, we don't know that, but we know these things and we can just move on. Whereas if I go look at the chart, you know, later in the day, and I'm fishing through everything and I see, oh, we did know this and I didn't have to do it. Or we did know this part and this person would have been a good candidate. That is not ideal. You see what I'm saying? So knowing that it's ambiguous is better than not knowing anything at all. And you may know certain things. And then the other thing to speak to that point is that when you have it sort of clear cut, sort of defined in like, you know, 4 or 5 lines of just answer, question, answer. What happens is that we don't have to fish through a paragraph or, you know, multiple documents to kind of put it together. It's all just immediately available for us. So you're right. You guys write this, you know, narrative of what happened, but sometimes we don't get that narrative until a little bit later when someone's fishing through the charts later. So if we had a sheet, we'll always get at least the essentials of what we need right there. It's just 5 lines. It has the pertinent questions and answers, and then we can make decisions based on that little information. We can get the rest of it later, what they were doing, how they did it, you know, how many times should I go.
The bigger problem with that, the sheet, kind of just like say we have a sheet that's like a checkoff list for us, right? The big problem is being able to fill it out while we're doing what we're doing.
Yeah.
And so it's not going to be something we'd have filled out and be able to walk in and be like, here's the sheet.
You know,
we'd give our report and we'd have to go back and fill it out and get our times from the dispatch and figure out when they were. So there would still be, even if you got it as close as possible and you remembered what time you did this or what time somebody said this to you, it's still a guesstimation at that point. Because it's all, the majority of the time, what he says the biggest problem is that it's, from the time we get the call and we get there, it's still a big guesstimation on when that person actually went down compared to when they called and when they were last seen, kind of like with a, you know, the stroke, unless it was witnessed.
Yeah.
And so, and those are very rare. So.
Right. And I understand that almost every measure, except when you actually physically get the patient, is going to be a guesstimation. Even when you get the patient, if you're going to give us some real time data, it's going to be a guesstimation. But I guess I would just say again that I think those guesstimations are still important.
Something is better than nothing.
Yes, exactly. So you might not have it. You're right. You might not be able to have it as you walk in the door. Give us this paper with everything down there. But if you know in your mind there's these 5 things I got to tell the doc when I get in there, even if you don't have it right down, even if you don't have the right times, you could say it was about 10 minutes of this, it was about 5 minutes of that, it was about 30 minutes of that. I'm not gonna, I mean, 5-10 minutes is not gonna really make or break us in that setting.
Yeah.
But it gives us a clear, direct opportunity to make decisions rather than wait until the end when you put it all together and give us exact times. So I just think, I guess what it is that, okay, exactly not the right time, but if you could keep in your mind what those things are so that when you come in, you can at least give a ballpark of whatever they said and whatever you got estimation, that's pretty much good enough.
So what I hear is that probably it would be better that we keep these questions when we're in a code situation, that the nurses bring this in and say, okay, tell me what this was, tell me what this was, tell me what this was. That's what I'm getting to you guys.
Or if it's at least something that, you know, at, we come in with an arrest and the nurses can give that to us and then we can go back and we can put in the information ourselves. Because standing there trying to relay information to you as we're transferring the patient and we've just given this, if we can get that sheet and we can have the time a few minutes after we've transferred care and go back and sit down and say, okay, this is what I was, and then give that back to you and say, okay, here's what I have as far as that's concerned.
That sounds perfect. And like you said, there'll be times where you give them the account and a lot of that information is already answered. So as long as the nurse has it, she'd be filling it in.
Yeah. Well, a lot of times we say things and there's so much going on that they're saying they hear us, but they're not actually hearing us.
And
we'll say it a couple times and they just ignore us, and if we get ignored a couple times,
sometimes they're ignored, they're just
I don't mean it as plain ignorance. They're doing other things. They can't, it's hard for them, you know, to remember all that stuff.
Now I understand we're looking at that 60-minute time window. Does how we get return of spontaneous circulation matter? Whether we get it through defibrillation or medication, does that make a difference to you guys?
It doesn't make a difference.
It doesn't make a difference.
It's just that when they get return of spontaneous circulation. Again, the rhythm that you got about, the initial rhythm matters.
Matters, whether it's VTAC.
Yeah, whether it's VTAC or VFib. VTAC and VFib will be about the same, but PEA or systole will be a little bit different.
Now, does the rhythm that we get them back into make a difference?
Not in terms of determining treatment regarding hypothermia, but in terms of further treatment, yes. So if you got them back and they were in SVT, you know, something like that, then we may have to do some other things to kind of, but that's something we would deal with. Just the question of whether or not they got return of spontaneous circulation within 60 minutes.
Why does it matter if they're 18 or older for the hypothermic protocol?
Well, it probably doesn't, but when we did all the studies looking at this with the hypothermic protocol, that was the criteria. So we don't really know what it does in patients younger than that.
Okay.
And you know, children's physiology is a little bit different, so cooling their temperatures down that low, we don't know how that affects them versus how it affects an adult.
Okay. I gave
them
just a sheet so
you
can see
the hypothermic protocol, Okay.
And I think they're working on pediatric actual hypothermia from what I understand. It's just, I don't think it's just been kind of rolled out for a lot of people to use. I mean, I've experienced it myself, two kids that were hypothermic arrest and they resuscitated with no injuries after the fact. So that's the study I think is ongoing currently.
I'll say, we've had quite a few in the county. Past years that have gone onto a pool in the wintertime, somewhere around there. And they, I know we have two in 1 year that's about.
So, just in general, just so you know, the hypothermic protocol, even though it's for patients who have a cardiac arrest, the misconception is that it's doing something for your heart, but the reality is what it's doing something for the brain. Okay, so the idea is that your brain has been ischemic, it's very sensitive to ischemic injury, and so by cooling the brain down, essentially, and cooling down the functions of the body, essentially you reduce the ischemic injury, and so they retain more of their brain function long term. And so we cool it down over that acute phase, 24 hours, and then kind of wean off, and that's that acute injury pattern that happens early on is kind of minimized. And so they retain brain function after they come off.
So it's showing better results being taken, like if say they survive and they're introduced into the hypothermia protocol or whatever, and then I imagine they're being slowly weaned off the hypothermia, right? And so it's showing less ischemic injuries and they're having more neurological function.
Exactly. They looked at neurologic function and survival, and there was a direct correlation with their neurologic status being on the hypothermia protocol versus not being.
And so
this guy did the hypothermia protocol. I mean, I think he was having seizures. He had some detrimental status when he came off. But the reality is that he came back full function. And it didn't look good at all. But he came back to full function after we weaned him off, after we took all drugs off and extubated him and everything. I think he had some mild neurologic deficits early on, but by discharge he was pretty close to baseline, and when I saw him in follow up he was back to his baseline.
How old was this patient?
34.
Big question, did he quit drinking? Did he quit abusing himself?
Yeah, exactly.
Oh, I see him again in a few
years. Yeah. Well, I saw him in the clinic and he it looked like he had turned it around. His family was there, they said to take a vouch for it. So I'm thinking that he did. I think most of his issues were kind of being young and thinking he was invincible, and he had some issues, so he was drinking and taking these energy drinks and smoking. But I think that he has cut off, because he wasn't really into the illicit drugs very much. It was just kind of like the smoking and the drinking and the energy drinks and the stress. So I think he was able to turn that around, and I hopefully he continues to do well. Any other questions? So we'll work on trying to get that set up so that it makes it work. Again, we don't want to make it so that you can't do your job on the field, but we want to make sure that we get that information. So however best you think makes it easy for you to relay that, perhaps we'll work on it.